Monster mutants lurk in the midst of many cultures. And we're fascinated, yet fearful, of nature's mutants. But mutants are closer to home than we think. Often invisible, mutations are happening all around us, in every living thing. They're a crucial part of evolution. Now research is uncovering how mutations actually work, and it may help us find cures for life-threatening diseases. As we understand more about mutation, we may discover more secrets of the history and future of life on this planet. In 19th century America, people flocked to dime museums to view the odd, the eerie, and the unexplained.
We are a recreation of a 19th century American dime museum. And dime museums, when they sprang up in this country, were full of anything the American public would pay 10 cents to see.
People have always been interested in the weird, the strange, the bizarre, the exotic, and the unusual.
For just 10 cents, they came to see the worst that nature had on offer. Some creatures were patently fake, products of an entrepreneur's imagination. But others brought us face to face with real mutations.
It is freaky, but it is. Look at it.
Across the Atlantic in Great Britain was a celebrated sideshow freak, Joseph Merrick, the famed Elephant Man. A tragic mutation within his genes gave rise to a disease called Proteus syndrome. Large bony growths covered the right side of his entire body. A mutation is a change in our genes. Deep within every cell, our chromosomes hold the instructions for life. These are our genes, and they're held on long, delicate strands of DNA. They read like a recipe book. But sometimes there's an unexpected change in part of the recipe. The result is an altered or damaged gene that we call a mutation. For Joseph Merrick, the mutation was so severe he could never lead a normal life. He spent his adult years as a sideshow freak until he was rescued and offered shelter at the Royal London Hospital. His short life ended at the age of 28. Today, such human tragedies are no longer a source of entertainment. But many of us are still fascinated by creatures that are one in a million. In West Fork, Arkansas, Fred Lally has spent 50 years collecting some most unusual reptiles. This is Zip, and his better half, Pip. With this member of Fred's menagerie, it's not clear if the left head knows what the right is doing.
They're both equally perfect heads, perfectly aware of everything, but one of them's more of a mild disposition, and the other one's a little grouch. And every now and then, it doesn't like me fooling with it, it nips me.
Fred has been fascinated by reptilian oddities all his life, and he now makes a living taking his mutant pets on tour to summer county fairs.
It's not the most lucrative business, but I do make a living at it, and I'm a free person.
But of all the animal anomalies he's encountered in his long career, one stands head and shoulders above the rest. Meet Golden Girls. She's no ordinary snake and came with no ordinary price tag. Fred paid $20,000 for one of the rarest reptiles in the world. But this isn't a case where two heads are really better than one.
Sometimes when she crawls, you'll see one head's wanting to go one way and one's another. That's very natural. It shows that both heads, and I would say they're near equal, but it seems like the head on the right usually gets its way. The main thing I watch for is that they don't breach an object their heads are formed into the body, somewhat like a Y. And it's easy for them to become impaled, I guess you could say, on a twig, a small shrub or something, and they can injure themselves.
Golden Girls wouldn't survive in the wild. She depends on Fred's care and attention. But what causes a two-headed mutation? At the University of Pennsylvania, Dr. Margaret Castle studies genetic diseases in young animals.
What I can show you here is a one-headed, two-bodied, conjoined pig twin. You can see it has one head here, clearly, and it has all arms, two on this side, two on the back side, and it has all of its legs, its hind legs, you can see down here. So it's actually a pig that has a complete separate spine from each other, so it's twins, but just one head. Typical conjoined twins.
In nature, conjoined twins are rare, but they nearly always make the slot at the end of the evening news bulletins.
This is Rudy, the two-headed pig. He's got two noses, two mouths, three eyes, and a personality.
Normally what you have is one egg gets fertilized by one single sperm. The cells then start to divide. Sometimes you will get a split in those cells and two separate individuals will form, twins. But sometimes that split doesn't quite make it, depending on where they're joined, is two heads or two bodies, four limbs, five limbs. You get a variety of different malformations caused by this not quite complete split.
In humans, if the embryo hasn't divided by the third week of pregnancy, then Siamese or conjoined twins may result. They're among the rarest of human beings. Only a few hundred pairs are born each year. More than half are stillborn and may live for only a few days. But are conjoined twins actually caused by mutation?
We think it's a combination of both genetics and environment, but nobody actually knows. We geneticists tend to be a little more careful and say, we call it a malformation at this point because we haven't been able to locate any genes to this day that actually cause conjoined twins.
But whether conjoined twins are mutations or not, they are only the tip of the mutation iceberg. Mutations are happening every day to all of us, but most of the time, they're invisible.
For me, a mutation is something that occurs all the time. It's a natural process. Many times, a mutation has no consequence. There's a change in the DNA, but that DNA is not important for the development of the embryo or the physiology of the organs.
When the cells in our body divide, they must replicate their DNA. Sometimes that's when a copying error can take place, but usually it's fixed up by our body's own correction system.
So we have proofreading enzymes, if you will, that actually zip along the DNA and they go and find a mistake and they get rid of it. They're quite efficient. They work in general. I mean, we'd be long dead if we didn't have these.
Proofreading enzymes fix up small mutations on a daily basis. But when they fail to do their job, that's when a mutation occurs.
A mutation can occur in any cell in the body, but if it occurs in a cell that gives rise to an egg or a sperm, and those egg or sperm are used to make a child, then that mutation is inherited and passed on to generations.
Those mutations could be detrimental and could cause things like birth defects, or they could be beneficial and cause, for instance, stronger bones or whiter teeth or a change in your hair or eye color. Or sometimes the mutations just make me different from you.
The townsfolk of Olney, Illinois, know only too well about color mutations. Their parks are filled with some of the cutest mutants on the planet, and every evening they come out to play. A population of albino squirrels has settled here and made the town their home. According to local folklore, the first pair of white squirrels appeared in 1902, when William Stroop found them in woods outside the city. Stroop captured the pair and displayed them in the local saloon. Later, they were released into City Park, where they started to breed. In their heyday in the 1940s, the population of albino squirrels reached almost 800. The townsfolk of Olney have given the squirrels pride of place, and they've helped shape the very identity of the town. Olney is not alone in treasuring its albinos. Whenever one of these rare white creatures is discovered, its strangeness captivates us.
Thought to be about 40 years old, the crocodile's creamy skin and pale whitish eyes are radically different from the colouring of normal crocs, and according to researchers, the syndrome is extremely rare. But at least they've named the rare creature. From today, he'll be simply Snowy.
And two-headedness isn't Golden Girl's only claim to fame. Normal rat snakes are black with a black tongue and eyes. Golden Girl's is also an albino, a case of being doubly blessed or doubly cursed. But whether it's an albino snake or an albino squirrel, the cause of their albinism is the same. Within every cell in the body, our genes hold the DNA instructions for how that body grows and functions. Amongst the thousands of genes in every cell, there are those that determine eye and hair color. In gray squirrels, these genes code for a pigment called melanin, which gives them gray fur and black eyes. But a mutation in these genes means little or no melanin is produced. So there's no color at all in the fur or the eyes. The result is an albino animal. Genes come in pairs, and every baby squirrel receives one from mum and one from dad. It's only when both parents pass on a mutated gene that the baby is an albino. The citizens of Olney pamper their squirrels, but dogs, cats, and other predators find the albinos easy pickings. Their eyesight is poor, and without any color for camouflage, they stand out. So these special creatures are at risk. To help more albinos survive, Olney has risen to the challenge. Police officers here are perhaps the only ones in the world charged with protecting albino animals. White squirrels have the right of way on city streets, and it's an offence to harm them in any way. The latest squirrel census shows that the population is now stable. It's the same the world over. Albino animals carry a slight disadvantage in the struggle for survival. This small mutation makes life just a little bit harder. But sometimes, a small mutation may be an advantage, giving some animals the edge over their competitors.
Mutations have allowed the whole animal, plant, human world to actually survive and make it in this world. Without mutations, we would probably die out when we encounter the first virus, for example. We wouldn't be able to survive.
700 years ago, a genetic mutation enabled a small group of human beings to survive a deadly disease. In the middle of the 14th century, the plague swept rapidly through Europe, killing 25 million people. That's a third of the population in just 4 years. But a small group of people managed to survive the deadly virus.
There was a small subset of people, less than 1%, who did not get plague, and they would survive no matter how bad the plague outbreaks were. About 300 years later, the number of these people had actually increased to about 10%. These people actually had a mutation that made them resistant to the plague bacteria. And later, so many years later, of course, these people increased because they were oftentimes the only survivors of the plague outbreaks.
The last great outbreak of plague occurred in the 17th century. In 1665, the Black Death struck London, taking 75,000 victims in its wake. In September of that year, George Vickers, a tailor in the small village of Eyam, received a parcel of cloth from London. It was ridden with plague-infected fleas. 4 days later, Vickers was dead. After many villagers succumbed at an alarming rate, the rector of the village made the momentous decision to quarantine the whole community. It was an heroic and radical act and prevented disease spreading to the surrounding district. But a year later, when the first outsiders ventured into Eyam, they were surprised to find that nearly half the townsfolk had actually survived. Now descendants of these survivors are helping researchers battle a modern-day plague. From previous work undertaken on HIV/AIDS, researchers had isolated a gene known as CCR5. When this gene is active, it allows the HIV virus to penetrate white blood cells, thus spreading the virus through the body. But in people who have the mutation, the HIV virus just can't get into the white blood cells. When researchers analyzed the blood samples from Eyam descendants, they found an unusually high number of people carrying the mutated version of the gene. This mutation may be the reason so many townsfolk survived in 1665 and could hold a key to preventing AIDS. But positive mutations aren't always a matter of life and death. A remarkable mutation arose after human beings first domesticated the cow. Our ancestors were quick to discover that cow's milk was similar to human milk, and so was a good source of nutrition. But there was just one hitch. Only babies could digest it without problems. Once people grew up, they found drinking milk gave them stomach cramps and nausea. They had lactose intolerance, which means they could no longer break down the sugars in milk. This was the norm for the majority of the population. But a lucky few were able to carry on enjoying milk as they grew up. They had a new advantage. A helpful mutation, which meant their lactose tolerance gene didn't switch off after childhood. Those with the new mutation thrived and may have been healthier than the rest. They certainly would have had stronger bones and teeth. They may have made more attractive mates and may even have had more children. So in populations where dairying became established, the new mutation slowly spread, enabling most people to enjoy drinking milk throughout their lives. And this new taste for cow's milk wasn't just confined to human beings.
Cats probably developed the ability to break down lactose along with humans. As we domesticated cattle and started using milk as a food source, cats that could break down lactose probably did a lot better than the cats that couldn't.
But this mutation was mainly helpful in northern European cultures, where dairying became the norm. But in cultures that didn't drink a lot of milk, the mutation simply didn't take hold. And even today, the majority of Africans and Asians are still lactose intolerant. They carry the original version of the gene. Ever since life began, mutations have enabled species to adapt to changing conditions. But mutations are actually random events and can occur for better or for worse. But there's another natural force that determines which mutations catch on and which fall by the wayside. Charles Darwin called it natural selection. If there's a disadvantage to a mutation, then it will probably die out. But if there's a positive advantage, then natural selection will ensure that it eventually spreads through the community. Working together, mutation and natural selection are the engines of evolution. Paleontologists can trace millions of years of evolutionary change packed into just a few centimeters of rock.
If we consider the history of life, which stretches back more than 500 million years, it's a history of change, and that change is governed by mutation. We do find that some lineages shifted fairly dramatically, perhaps in response to, say, changing climate or changing food resources or maybe some sort of change in the type of predator that was after it.
When environments begin to change, mutations offer random solutions. An advantageous mutation might help a species survive the new situation, while another species may be faced with extinction.
In fact, extinction's really the bread and butter of the history of life, strange to say. And if we think about the groups that went extinct, our normal explanation is that extinction means inability to adapt, that particular lineages of fossils just haven't been able to change enough to keep pace with the changing Earth. And so those organisms weren't mutating enough, they weren't changing enough.
While the fossil record gives us a condensed history of evolutionary change, we can see living examples of evolution in action on many of the world's islands. Island populations offer a unique glimpse of how mutation and natural selection can work very quickly under the right conditions.
So when you think about a population of organisms or species, that population contains a large amount of variation, genetic variation, which is mutation has produced over millennia. But when you take two organisms and you put them on an island isolated from the main population where they came from, they're only taking a small part of the variation that they came from. And that may lead to differences in that population arising very, very rapidly. And that's where you tend to see evolutionary change, because when you have small populations, natural selection acts much more strongly.
On his famed visit to the Galapagos Islands in 1835, Charles Darwin was fascinated to find so many unique species found nowhere else on Earth. His hunch was that the ancestors of these unique animals had somehow hitchhiked their way from the mainland. And once on the islands, they'd evolved in isolation, each adapting to the new environments they encountered. On the islands, he counted 13 different species of finches. Some lived in the trees, others lived on the ground. Some ate insects, and others ate plants and berries. He concluded that one original founding species had, over time, evolved into 13. Each one taking on new roles in the island environment. It was the same everywhere he looked. Even the tortoises had evolved so that you could tell which island they came from just by looking at the shape of their shells. Had Darwin ever visited the island of Sulawesi in Southeast Asia, he would have found much the same story. Here, the island's early arrivals have evolved into 100 unique species that exist nowhere else. This grey macaque monkey lives on the south coast and is probably closest to the original macaques that rafted here nearly 2 million years ago. Compare that to the black-crested macaque that lives on the northern tip of the island. It's hard to believe that both have descended from common ancestors. But it's the humble monitor lizard that provides the most remarkable example of island evolution. This hardy traveller has colonised many islands in Indonesia, and depending on the situation, has evolved into some strikingly different forms. On an island to the east of Sulawesi, the omnivorous monitor lizard has evolved into the emerald tree monitor, a small and gentle leaf eater, which uses its tail to balance delicately in the canopy. But on the island of Komodo, where there were no large mammal predators, the descendants of the monitor lizard have filled the gap in a most impressive way. They've evolved into the largest and most fierce lizard in the world, the Komodo dragon. Since life began on Earth, mutation and natural selection have been the twin driving forces behind evolution. But now, a relative newcomer on the scene, Homo sapiens, has begun engineering evolution to suit himself. By selecting mutations and breeding from them, we humans are changing the world to the way we want it. Around 2000 BC, natives of North India took the wild red jungle fowl, Gallus gallus, into their farmyards. And so, the domestic chicken was born. Ever since, they've been selectively bred for their eggs, tasty flesh, and even fanciful decoration.
Eventually a mutation pops up somewhere. These happen randomly. This is a normal occurrence. So somebody finds an individual that has the qualities that they are looking for, and then they pick that and breed it to one that's most similar. So this is an old, old process that's been known for thousands of years. You breed similar to similar and you'll get similar.
Wild roses, which grew on the planet some 50 million years before humans, have now been selectively bred over the centuries to produce the sensuous array of blooms we enjoy today. Koi carp have been glittering jewels in the ponds of their admirers for over 400 years. Originally domesticated as a food source by peasant farmers in northern Japan, they then became living works of art.
By virtue of the terrain that they lived in, along these long, winding, narrow ravines and gullies, just dotted with thousands of ponds, they were able to notice some of the mutations in their fish. So they put them in different ponds and started developing them. The result of that was that instead of having one or two people that were experimenting in mutations, you had hundreds of geneticists, so to speak, that were really evolving these fish.
We've even engineered evolution to produce man's best friend. The dog was in fact our first domesticated animal.
Wait. Go.
Whether big or small, bred for working or bred to be the family pooch, they've all descended from one common ancestor, the wolf.
What happened was that certain people found that there were certain subgroups of wolves that seemed to be more tame than others, and these they made then to their companions, and then by selective breeding together what they thought was appropriate for their needs or uses, that's how then the modern day dog most likely evolved.
Many believe that wolves adopted humans rather than the other way around. Perhaps wolves scavenged for scraps around early human campsites, and puppies were taken into cave dwellings to be tamed and kept as pets. Whatever the scenario, it's clear that the partnership between dogs and humans was of mutual benefit. Dogs are social animals, and they enjoyed the protection, shelter, and easy access to food that humans provided. As pack animals, they soon came to recognize the human as the alpha dog or leader. In turn, humans found in the dog a loyal protector and devoted companion. Hunting became easier, and life was safer with an animal that could guard the campsite at night. Perhaps different groups of people domesticated different breeds of dog. And by the time of the Roman Empire, most of the breeds we know today were already established. Humans used the genetic variability of early dogs to breed for specific characteristics. Intelligent and confident dogs were bred together to produce sheepdogs. Today, the heading dog can hunt in a pack the way its ancestors did. It instinctively rounds up its prey animal. Its uncanny ability to stare down the sheep is like its wolf ancestor. But generations of selective breeding means these dogs will only hunt. They won't kill. But some breeds have strayed far from their original purpose and clearly would not survive without us. Brenda Heinsen owns a most unusual dog. When Brenda's daughter was born allergic to dog hair, she searched for a dog that wouldn't trigger reactions. They discovered the Xolo, or Mexican hairless dog. No one knows when this hairless mutation first occurred, but it's thought the breed originated in the warm climate of northern Africa. But extreme artificial selection has its downsides.
Associated with the hairless gene is a lack of the premolar teeth. And you also will see either very stunted or a total absence of the canine teeth. Also, and it doesn't pose any problem for them because they eat just as well. I mean, they don't have a problem with food.
Hairlessness may be a bonus for Brenda and her family, but for the Xolo, the lack of protective fur isn't.
Too much sun and he will get sunburnt. If you leave him exposed to the sun too long, just like with a person, they can be prone to skin cancer. You have to be very careful with that.
Like hairless dogs, we humans are also prone to sunburn, which can lead to skin cancer, another type of cell mutation.
Probably one of the most well-known is UV irradiation from the sunlight. Everybody knows you expose yourself too much to the sunlight, you may get cancer because it will change the DNA, the genetic makeup of the skin cells. So each cell has a little blueprint. So if you change that, you get uncontrolled growth, which is basically cancer.
Ultraviolet radiation can have devastating effects on our DNA, causing replicating cells to lose the ability to switch off. Cells grow randomly, and cancerous tumors can develop. Radiation from sunlight is a mutagen, an outside force that can cause a mutation in our DNA. But we're also affected by chemical mutagens, and they pop up in some surprising places. The humble barbecue can create a deadly weapon against the human body. Fat drippings from meat can burn. In the resulting smoke are chemicals called PAHs. It's all just part of that barbecue flavor. But once eaten, PAHs can pass into your cells and damage your DNA. Different mutagens cause their damage in different ways.
They can scramble your DNA completely. They can take large chunks of your DNA out, invert them, or put them on the other strand. Or you can have just huge deletions, meaning that whole sections of DNA will be missing completely, just zap, gone.
The whole world witnessed the effects of a most powerful mutagen during the Second World War, when America unleashed the terrifying specter of atomic warfare. In August 1945, they detonated two atomic bombs, the first on the city of Hiroshima, the second on Nagasaki. The bombs caused widespread devastation and left a lethal legacy of radiation.
After the atomic bomb, it was noticed that there were many defects that were inherited in the offspring of the survivors. And so a lot of research started in trying to determine how radiation affected DNA and how strongly it affected DNA.
When Watson and Crick discovered the structure of DNA in 1953, the science of genetics was coming of age. We now knew that all genes were made up of a series of three-letter codes, and that even one tiny error in the code could cause a mutation. But the genesis of genetic research began much earlier in the century. One of its unsung heroes is the humble fruit fly.
Fruit flies have been critical to genetic research for almost 100 years now. And the real reasons behind it is that fruit flies are excellent model organisms. They're really easy to grow in the laboratory. They don't have many diseases. They're very robust, so it's quite difficult to make fruit flies sick. So we can produce mutations in fruit flies, and the fruit flies will still survive. Another good reason for using fruit flies is that they only have four chromosomes, which makes analyzing their genetics very, very easy.
Early in the 20th century, Thomas Morgan bred fruit flies to track how certain characteristics could be passed on from generation to generation. Long before the discovery of the structure of DNA, his research on fruit flies proved that our genes are contained in chromosomes within every living cell. Later, people added to this original knowledge, so that in genetic research, the fruit fly became the most studied living creature of all time.
But one of the fantastic things about fruit flies is that they're very, very cheap to work with. And that meant that they were tended to be given to students. So there was a young community of researchers, and they had a philosophy that everything should be shared amongst them. So if one person produced a mutant line of flies, that line of flies had to be available to the rest of the community. And that meant that fruit fly research really rocketed because everyone was sharing information and sharing ideas.
More recently, scientists have discovered a group of genes which determine body shape and body pattern. If you alter these genes in fruit flies, you get some very interesting mutations, such as stumpy wings, curly wings, and even legs coming out of the head in place of antennae. But does any of this research relate to human beings?
We find the same genes which are doing similar jobs in fruit flies are doing the same jobs in humans. What that means is that fruit fly research is incredibly useful because it enables us, in a simple system, to understand how genes work. Once we have that information from a simple organism, we can try and use that to understand what's happening in more complex organisms like humans.
Using fruit flies, scientists have just found that a so-called chaperone protein may be able to hide or paper over small mutations in the gene code. It's a discovery that has major implications. Over the generations, a family of flies can accumulate many mutations that are hidden harmlessly away. When this protein is working, these mutations never see the light of day. But if it stops doing its job, then mutations that were invisible suddenly appear.
And you find that the fruit fly strain that you've been looking at actually has a mutation you never knew about. And this is incredibly important for evolutionary research because it means that organisms can build up inside their own genes a degree of variation which is never seen in the environment. But under stressful circumstances, a change in the environment, change in temperature, those mutations can pop out, appear in the environment, and perhaps be selected by natural selection.
If the study of genetics was a major motion picture, then the fruit fly would take the leading role. But to learn more about human genetics, scientists have turned to animals that are a little closer to us on the evolutionary tree. Mice are fast becoming the new superheroes of genetic research. At Baylor College of Medicine in Houston, Texas, geneticist Monica Justice is researching mutation in mice. Monica's work involves studying genetic diseases in mouse populations with the goal of applying that knowledge to the same diseases in humans. Monica and her team use a powerful chemical mutagen to cause mutations in her mouse population which mimic similar conditions in humans. They introduce this chemical mutagen directly into mouse sperm cells. From the offspring, she identifies mutant mice that show signs of a health defect. She then breeds these mutants to create whole families of mice with the same condition.
Right now, I have approximately 30,000 mice. And these mice all have different mutations. So some of the mutations cause birth defects. Some of them cause changes in their skin or coat. The mice have almost the same profile of genetic diseases as you would find in the human population.
Whole families of mutant mice are then treated for their various conditions.
And that's one of the advantages of mice over humans. Usually if we have a disease in humans, we may choose not to have more children or something, but we can produce lines of mice that produce this disease. And then we can determine how that disease might be treated.
Research in this area has highlighted new knowledge about genetic diseases.
So if you take a disease such as osteoporosis, you might predict that this certain gene causes osteoporosis, and in fact it might. But what we're learning is that this gene can cause osteoporosis if mutated, but so can another gene on this chromosome and a different gene on this chromosome and yet another gene. So we're finding that mutations in many different genes could contribute to a single disease.
Across the street at the MD Anderson Cancer Center, researchers are creating mouse mutations in different ways. They're targeting individual genes and altering them with pinpoint accuracy. It's a fiddly business, but it's actually possible to insert new genes into a mouse by micro-injecting foreign DNA directly into a fertilized mouse egg.
So you have a very, very fine needle, and that pierces the egg and goes into the nucleus, and a solution of DNA is pumped in. Then you can transfer them back into a surrogate mother, and she'll give birth to babies. And some of those babies will have incorporated this DNA into their genomes. Then we can breed these mice and see in the progeny of these animals that carry this DNA, what is the impact of this gene on the animal.
It's incredible that within only 50 years of discovering the structure of DNA, we now have the tools to cut and paste it so precisely. Richard's latest research is on human ovarian cancer.
This is a very serious cancer for women. It's usually detected very late. And because it's detected very late, the treatment options are not great. So we decided to use our technologies to model this disease in mice.
The team is targeting a mutant gene that's strongly associated with ovarian cancer. They've even constructed this mutant gene in the lab. The next step is to insert the mutant gene into developing mouse embryos. The mutant gene replaces the normal one, slotting itself into the exact same position in the mouse genome. The results are preliminary, but they think that normally this gene regulates cell division, and so the mutant version may cause cells to divide abnormally.
So this is interesting to us because cancer is really abnormal cell proliferation.
Further tests suggest that this mutant gene may also play a part in other forms of cancer.
So these are very basic steps, very basic findings, and we're hoping by pursuing this gene and creating other models in mice of ovarian cancer that we can contribute to the therapies that might be used for this very serious cancer.
Molecular biology works on such a minute scale that it's difficult to keep track of which mice are carrying which mutations. After all, these genetic changes are taking place on a scale that's invisible to the human eye. So researchers have come up with a clever method of keeping track of all their mouse mutants. They add a fluorescent jellyfish gene alongside the gene of medical interest. Now the mice that have an active mutant gene are easy to find because they glow under blue light. In nature, mutations are slow and random. In the lab, researchers are stepping in to make them fast and surgically precise.
It's really remarkable the pace that mouse genetic technology is moving. At this point in time, we can almost do anything we want to the genome of a mouse. We can add genes, we can take away genes, we can clone mice, we can freeze embryos and store them for decades.
I think in 50 years we'll look back on mouse genetics and say that the mouse was one of the most powerful genetic organisms. So they will join the ranks of bacteria, yeast, worms, flies, in showing us how we develop, how disease develops, what types of mutations can cause diseases, and even better, how we can treat them.
Of all nature's forces, it's mutation that's been the most misunderstood. While freakish mutations grab the headlines, few of us realize that mutation is a natural part of the ongoing cycle of life. In the evolutionary big picture, it provides the variation species need to adapt to an ever-changing world. Under the microscope, understanding how it really works may hold the key to conquering life-threatening diseases. Mutation is change. Some changes are for better, some for worse. But change will always be with us, so long as there is life on Earth.